Jordyn Brooks was one of the biggest surprises in the first round of the 2020 NFL Draft. The Seahawks have Bobby Wagner, they have KJ Wright, and they drafted Cody Barton and Ben Burkervin in their third and fifth round picks in last year's NFL Draft. The linebacker position on this team didn't seem like a major need, when you consider the fact that they desperately needed help at edge rusher and long-term solutions across the offensive line. This pick did seem to come out of nowhere. It's clear though that the Seahawks felt differently. In Pete Carroll's and John Schneider's press conferences, they claimed that Brooks was the best player on their board and that he'll give them long-term success at a major position on this defense. Now, as we think about the Seahawks, there is truth that the linebacker position in Pete Carroll's 4-3 under defense is extremely important. Using a combination of one gap and two gap principles up front, the inside and outside linebackers in this defense are responsible for making everybody right. They have a lot of responsibilities and they need to be versatile. They have to be able to defend the run, they have to be great in pass coverage, and they on occasion have to blitz as well. While this may seem true for most defenses, the linebacker position with Bobby Wagner and KJ Wright for the last 8 years has been the bright spot on this defense holding everything together. Just two seasons ago, I thought Wagner should have won Defensive Player of the Year, and I made a video of his incredible performance right here on this channel. His play was so good and so monumentally important for this defense that I understand why the Seahawks felt like they needed to address his position early. So let's talk about Jordyn Brooks. In this video, we're going to go over his three phases of his game and talk about how he looked using both his 2018 and 2019 film. I'll explain why we had to go back two seasons in order to do a proper evaluation of Brooks shortly. Let's start with his run defense, because as a run defender, this is where Brooks excels. He's a downhill thumping linebacker that is quick enough to avoid blockers, and he has some pop that he generates on his hits. He uses his hands well to disengage for blocks, and he wraps and rolls to take down running backs with violence. If you watched him from 2018 to 2019, this is one area that he definitely improved on. He seemed to bulk up for the Mike linebacker position, and it definitely paid off. He was a lot better as a run defender than he was the previous season. Let's look at this play against Arizona. After the snap, Brooks sees that Arizona is running a counter to the right. He steps into the A-gap to ensure the running back doesn't have an easy hole to cut through, forcing him to bounce outside. Once the running back clears this gap, Brooks uses his hands to keep his frame clean, and then he showcases his sideline to sideline speed to chase the running back towards the sideline and take him down. This is a really good play. Looking over his film, Brooks is a monster against the run and was one of the best run defending linebackers in this draft. His ability to jump between gaps and secure them to force running backs away is really impressive. Also, he created 20 tackles for loss last season. He was constantly jetting to the backfield with his elite speed to take down ball carriers for big plays. At the combine, he ran a 4.54 40-yard dash, and it clearly shows. The crazy part is that he claims he only spent about a week preparing for that run, as he had shoulder surgery about 3 months prior. If this is true, this is absolutely insane. Now, looking at the NFC West, this conference features the likes of Kyle Shanahan and his wide zone running game, Sean McVay and all of his motions before the snap, and Kyler Murray with Cliff Kingsbury. The Seahawks had to get faster in order to defend against these teams. The moment that Brooks steps onto the field, he'll drastically increase the overall speed of this defense instantly. Now, after watching him over the last two seasons, I think he plays at a very high level against the run. His only drawback is that he needs to improve at anticipating blockers releasing from the first level to the second level. He'll sometimes get behind blocks when he's caught watching the action unfolding in the backfield. With how these three offenses operate, specifically targeting the linebackers, this is something Brooks will need to get better at. Once he does this though, Brooks will become one of the premier run-stopping linebackers in the NFL just like that. Before we move on to pass coverage, because I do have a lot to say about his ability against the pass, let's first talk about him as a blitzer. This is where Brooks really shines. On 117 pass rush attempts last season, Brooks created 44 pressures. That's an absurd number considering that every third rush, he was able to pressure or hit the quarterback. Brooks goes from stop to start instantly, and he can shut down passing plays when a quarterback attempts to escape outside. Now, obviously, blitzing in the NFL won't be as easy as it was for him in college. Blocking schemes and offensive lines are simply better. But since the Seahawks run a ton of stunts up front, Brooks should be able to help them with those. Additionally, if I was the defensive coordinator, I would also run some cool fire zone blitzes using Brooks' speed as a weapon. I think he offers a lot of value in that regard. Moving on, while defending the run and blitzing are important responsibilities of this job, covering the pass is what differentiates you in the NFL. If you can cover, you'll be a three-down linebacker and you'll always have value as a starter. The ability to drop into zone coverage with spatial awareness, the ability to mirror slot receivers, and the ability to recognize what the offense is trying to run are all very important tasks of this position. What's interesting is that if you've been following the scouting community or other various draft experts, they'll be the first to tell you that Brooks can't cover. Now, what would happen if I told you the exact opposite? What would happen if I told you that he has the potential to cover and he showed it, but his role in Texas Tech's defense is the main culprit for why many people believe he can't do this in the first place? So what exactly do I mean? As I mentioned at the start of this video, I went back through both of his 2018 and 2019 seasons. This is the reason why. In 2019, Brooks played a completely different position than he did during his 2018 season. In 2019, he was the Mike linebacker for the Red Raiders defense. In this role, he attacked downhill sitting at 3 to 5 yards past the line of scrimmage. He was asked to shut down the run, spy the quarterback, and watch the backfield running delayed blitzes to help the defensive line create pressure. This was not his role in 2018. In 2018, he was the outside linebacker in their system. He mostly played outside the tackles, apexing the seams, and he dropped into pass coverage way more frequently. He still did come inside and run stunts and blitzes for a good portion of his role, but again, he still did have more pure pass coverage snaps in 2018 than he did last season. Based on my film study, I was actually pretty impressed with what I saw back in 2018. He had really nice fluidity to his movements, and he can mirror offensive players pretty well. In 2019, however, he was relegated to that spy role like I said before, which was just incredibly frustrating to watch. This role didn't give him a chance to do what he does best. Check out this snap against Texas back in 2018. In this play, Brooks mirrored the slot receiver perfectly using his speed and hip flexibility to completely shut down the passing play. Seeing this play really begs the question, if I have a player that can stick to tight ends and running backs in space, why the hell didn't Texas Tech use him in that role in 2019? The reason, from my understanding, is two-part. First, Texas Tech hired a new head coach in 2019. Cliff Kingsbury went to the NFL to coach the Cardinals, and his replacement, Matt Wells, took over the job for Brooks' final year in college. Additionally, at the end of the 2018 season, Dakota Allen, who was their Mike linebacker, he graduated and left the NFL. The Red Raiders needed a new Mike linebacker, one that possessed leadership and one that possessed the strength to shut down the running lanes in the middle. This is why Jordyn Brooks switched into this role in his final year in college. He bulked up a bit, became stouter against the run, and Texas Tech wanted to use his ridiculous speed to help the defense create pressure. So now the question comes down to why people believe Brooks is bad in coverage. In my opinion, the reason is due to the difference in pass coverage responsibilities between these two positions. As an outside linebacker, you are responsible for flat curl zones. You are responsible for running backs releasing outside. You are also responsible for apexing between the tight end and the slot receiver, carrying the number two up the seam. This is what I showed in that play against Texas. Additionally, you are also using spot zone coverage as well. Out of these four types of coverages, dropping into spot zone coverages was by far Brooks' biggest weaknesses that I saw in film. At times, he just seemed a bit lost in terms of his route recognition, and he didn't seem to have the best idea of zone spatial awareness either. So, now let's fast forward a year later, and Brooks is now the Mike linebacker in this defense. Out of those four roles that I mentioned previously, can you guess which of those that Brooks did the most in 2019? Brooks isn't carrying seam routes anymore, he rarely will use his speed and agility in the flat curl zones either, and for the vast majority of his snaps, when he wasn't playing in that spy linebacker role in this defense, he would occasionally drop into spot zone coverage. As I already told you, this is the one type of coverage that Brooks simply isn't the best at. To me, this is the biggest issue. The Red Raiders purposely sacrificed his ability to cover outside and up the seams because they needed to get stouter against the run and help pressure the quarterback. While both of those roles do have value in the pros, pass coverage is king in the modern NFL. This is why people have been freaking out claiming that Brooks can't cover. Based on everything I've seen, this is why I'm not nearly as worried as the rest. In the Seahawks defense, Pete Carroll has already said that he'll use him as the dual outside to inside linebacker. This is what we saw from him during the 2018 season. They are clearly using that tape as opposed to his 2019 tape to make their evaluation and project how he'll fit in their defense. In my opinion, I think this is extremely smart. Brooks can become an excellent outside linebacker first when they play in their 4-3 defense, and when the Seahawks run their 4-2-5 nickel defense, Brooks still has plenty of potential as well. Now, as for the spot zone coverages, I'm not going to lie to you and tell you that he'll never have to do them. This isn't true. It's still one of his weaknesses, and Brooks needs to improve on his recognition of routes entering and exiting his zones. He needs to get a better understanding of which routes to take and which routes to pass, and he needs to get a better sense at how offenses are specifically designed to attack you in front and behind. Right now, Brooks too frequently covers grass with poor spatial awareness, and I think that's the main thing he needs to work on. What gives me hope, though, and what makes me optimistic, is that Brooks seems like a coachable player. During games, whenever he made a mistake, either in run defense or pass coverage, he seemed to fix it on the very next time he was asked to do it. Like, if he didn't cover a flare route that I thought he was responsible for, he covered it perfectly on the very next play. This is what gives me hope. Now, before I wrap this up, the one thing you may have noticed throughout this video is that you've probably seen a lot of repeats in terms of the film I chose to illustrate some of these concepts. If you notice that, there's a valid reason. Like I said before, during his 2018 and 2019 seasons, his snaps and pure pass coverage were few and far in between. I'll be the first to admit that there is definitely a level of projection that you have to make with his current ability. Some of the snaps I saw were excellent, while others were simply not good and made you want more. To end this breakdown, I get why Seahawks fans were frustrated by this pick. Initially, when I heard his name, I myself was pretty frustrated as well. However, I didn't see what the coaching staff saw until I went back to his 2018 film. His role during that season is way more in line with what he'll be asked to do with the Seahawks. That's something that should make you happy if you're a fan of this team. Brooks is a great fit in this defense, playing that outside-inside role. Yes, there are definitely things he needs to work on. We went over them in detail in this video. But out of all the first-round picks that the Seahawks have made over the last 5 years, this includes the LJ Colliers, the Rashaad Pennies, the Germain Ifedis, Jordyn Brooks is by far my favorite. Pete Carroll knows what he's getting at with his pick, and once he starts learning from Bobby Wagner as his mentor, I think Brooks has a serious chance at proving all of his doubters wrong. Well, that's all I have for you. In my next film room on this channel, I think I'll continue looking at a few of my favorite picks from this NFL draft. Then after that, we'll move on to off-season content. I have a full slate of videos that I want to work on, and as we're all still trapped inside, I think you're really going to enjoy them. If you liked my work and want to support the channel, feel free to follow the link to my Patreon account below. Also, you can follow me on Twitter at Samuel R. Gold.